And we are really excited to have you all. This is a very important event in life of ONOS and the open source network operating system. Let me take a minute to introduce my co-host, Tom Anschutz from AT&T. He has been behind one of the key persons behind Domain 2.0 at AT&T. And also, he has been our champion, has been collaborator and so on ONOS for a year or more. And so we really appreciate that. And so he and I put this ONOS summit together. And we are really going to be pretty democratic about this opening talk. We are going to alternate between two of us, okay? So, okay, so let me get started. But Tom, it's yours.
Oh, it's all mine. Well, hi again. I'm Tom Anschutz from AT&T, and I'm here to bore you, help you understand all about ONOS in the next little while. So today we have a great opportunity for you to learn about what we've been doing for sort of the last year or so in developing ONOS. We're going to present ONOS, this open network operating system, and go through some of the use cases. What is it good for, right? And then we're going to share kind of our plans to kind of suck you into an open source community where we think that working together, we can make ONOS so much more than it is today. And of course, along that process, we're really interested in understanding your feedback and helping set direction for the industry in general.
Okay. And so in case you are hearing about ONOS for the first time, I don't think that is the case for any one of you here, but still, so the idea is, as you know, we think of software-defined networking as a paradigm shift. And the idea behind ONOS is to really bring that disruptive SDN value proposition to service providers. Okay, so that is what we are driven by. That's what the mission of this particular project and initiative is. And when we talk about that SDN value proposition, the idea is really to help service provider reduce significantly the CapEx, OpEx, as well as being able to innovate and bring new revenue-generating services on their infrastructure. And that is what the disruptive SDN value proposition is all about. And so what that translates to is that we want to enable the web-style agility or cloud-style agility and programmability on the infrastructure so our service providers themselves or third parties or vendors are able to create new capabilities, new revenue-generating services much more quickly as we do today on the web infrastructure. Another thing is enable service providers to move from closed proprietary boxes to infrastructure that is built using white boxes in order to make it easier as well as simpler and cheaper for service providers. And while we do that, we have to make sure that we maintain scalability, high availability, performance, and all of that. These are the features that service providers and carriers care about. And when we do this transformation, we have to make sure that we are not compromising on those key capabilities that they care about. Okay, so that is what ONOS is about. Oh, so I think there is an animation. Should I build it out?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead. So why service provider networks? I think Guru just kind of walked through a lot of these things, right? That we're very interested in sort of changing the basic mechanism around which carrier networks are constructed and maintained and improved over time. And we're very hopeful that by changing those kinds of processes and approaches, that will make it much more efficient or much more lower in CapEx and OpEx in order to be able to build those kinds and run those kinds of networks. And one of the things that we'd like to bring along for the ride there is sort of to borrow, if you will, from IT folks, some of the cloud agility, some of the ways that our operations go in cloud and IT centers. And we think that the kinds of flexibility and scalability and the sort of scale-out architectures that you see typical of cloud are something we'd like to bring back into SDN and into telecom or network forwarding kinds of functions. We want to roll out the services very rapidly, and we really want to change how operations occur. If you look at how many people an AT&T puts in place to manage a CO full of routers versus how many people our own IT department puts in place to manage the same sort of space full of servers, there's a big discrepancy. And one of the things we're interested in is reducing operational complexity. So But we do have lots of requirements, right? There's a whole cultural and tradition that goes around carrier networks, and starting with the old mantra of five nines, right? That it has to be highly available. But I think in many ways we're trying to get over creating availability by boxes, by creating boxes that cannot fail, right? We're looking really toward creating availability from agile and scale-out architectures instead. The carrier networks have some unique inputs or unique requirements in terms of size and scale. So we talk about, if you talk about broadband lines, we're talking about tens of millions of customers just for AT&T. And if you look at the entire, the world is got at least 300 or 400 million wireline broadband subscribers. And then for wireless, once again, just looking at AT&T, we're well over 100 million wireless subscribers. It's a lots of numbers, right? And so it needs to scale well. And then finally, ease of use. We're really interested in kind of breaking the barrier of nobody knows how networking works, and everybody has to sort of resort to a common cookie cutter or cookbook method to get them to work. We're looking for real innovation in networking. You know, something, how long have we been using sockets? And all right, I'll leave it at that. And then finally, one of the things that's really interesting is previously in networks, if you wanted to have a new service or a new kind of feature, let's say I had a IPv6 and I wanted to deploy it in my network, I probably would have to either get a firmware update for boxes I already have, or I might have to buy all new boxes, right? This is the typical modus operandi. You have a new software feature or a network feature, and you wind up creating an entire overlay network to support it. And what we're very interested in is moving a lot of those functions and features into software so that new capabilities and upgrades wind up becoming software on the same hardware as opposed to brand new hardware being deployed.
Okay. So, as you know, we have been working on ONOS for almost like 2 years, and there have been a number of companies that we have been working with. So, and so these are, of course, AT&T, NTT Communications. So these were the two service providers. As we said, ONOS is all about bringing SDN value to service providers. So it was very, very important to us to have service providers participate, contribute, and are active members of it. And we were very fortunate that AT&T and NTT Communications joined this, as well as we have some research and education service providers like Internet 2 and other research and education network operators in Europe. So that is good. And then we also teamed up with a number of vendors who are also very motivated to bring disruptive SDN value proposition to service providers. And so that is particularly the group of companies that we have been working for last year or more to create this open source network operating system.
Tom? Yeah, this is really tough, right? Guess what? Something happened just last Friday, and that the first release, Avocet, was open sourced by ON.Lab and the partners you saw on the previous chart. And so you're welcome to go right now to the website and download and you know, have your way with ONOS.
So let me tell you, so as part of the highlights of this, right? So as we were getting ready to open source, we had two webinars in terms of one, the introduction of webinar, and then another one, deep dive. And we are very pleased. There were 700 plus people registered, 500 plus attended the overview one. The deep dive webinar, 600 plus people registered, 400 plus attended, and what was very pleasant surprise to us is more than 200 people stayed on until after 2 hours and didn't want to quit. There were a list of questions, comments, and all of that. So that was very nice. And you know, for something like an SDN operating system, that level of participation and engagement was very heartening to us. And then, as Tom mentioned, we released it on Friday, December 5th. And again, we are very pleasantly surprised in terms of the type of traction we are getting. There are 400 downloads, and you can read all of the statistics. They are pretty encouraging. Again, this is not the hottest iPhone application or a video game or a trailer for a Hollywood movie. But for an SDN operating system that is distributed network operating system, having 400 people download it in 4 days and try to play with it is a very good kind of recognition, and we can see the interest there. Okay?
Okay, so the next slide is why one more open source project, right? So how many SDN controllers are out there in the wild today? There's got to be well over a dozen, right, between commercial and academic controllers. So one of the things, and we're going to lead you through a number of things actually, why we think that the work was worthwhile undertaking and why you might be interested in participating in ONOS. The first is that we have sort of the active participation of service providers. So if you're looking for a way to express your needs and your requirements for a network operating system that's suitable for carrier networks, it's a good thing to participate in ONOS. As an SDN OS, it starts with kind of a focus, and like a lot of the folks from ON.Lab have kind of been or had their toes in the clean slate programs that came before, and it's well suited toward the kind of infrastructure, the kind of white box infrastructure that you might expect or want to be able to use and manipulate in a sort of a clean slate approach. The ON.Lab team has had a kind of small group that helps focus, shepherd, and project manage the work up until this point. And so you didn't necessarily start off with a lot of chaos to get the project going. And we do have, as you saw a couple of charts ago, a nice set of active vendors that are participating in the development of the OS. So it's not like, you know, people who don't understand network elements are trying to put together an OS. And then, as we get to later in the day, we'll talk about how we think there's going to be a fairly unique governance approach for ONOS, and that you know, we're looking toward a meritocracy. We're trying to build something that's really useful and good, right? And then we think that ON.Lab can help provide sort of a neutral role in that, in sort of brokering solutions.
Okay. So who is here in terms of, this is an invitation only event. We only invited a group of companies that we thought are ready and willing to become partners with us. And so we have current partners, obviously, AT&T, NTT Communication, all the vendors that we have been working with, some of our other partners and collaborators who have been contributing to ONOS, and then prospective partners. And again, here you will see the list in terms of number of service providers and carriers. And again, this is a reflection of how we think about ONOS and SDN. We have a pretty good set of potential partners that are, again, coming from the service provider and carrier space. And we are hoping that they will participate and contribute. And then, of course, we also have vendors who we think are really interested in wanting to bring about this disruptive change to the networking. Okay?
Okay, so here's the... Thank you, Drew. So what are we going to get into today? I know there's a second one you're going to have to deal with. So this is basically the agenda. Right now we're in the welcome, and we're going to go then, and well, as you can see, we're going to go a little bit into how AT&T looks at open source and on SDN. And then we're going to hear from Nick about SDN and open source and ONOS. Then you'll have to deal with me again for a little while to hear about some of the use cases that AT&T has contributed toward ONOS. And as you can see, then we're going to hear from NTT about ONOS, and then finally from TELUS. So in the morning session, it's a lot about how carriers are involved, what their requirements are, and how ONOS use cases come about to support those carriers' needs. Then we'll have a break. And then come back and talk a little bit more in depth about what is ONOS, how is it architected, and sort of get into the meat and potatoes of ONOS. And then there'll be lunch.
And some demos. I think we have some demos, so please, I know this is a very tight schedule, but during lunch, if you can take the time to see the demo, appreciate that, because you know people, and you can, they can answer questions and so on. Okay, so then the afternoon session is, it starts with some of our vendor partners to stand up and talk about what they have been doing with ONOS, use cases and so on, their perspective. And that's very important as well. And then we have Black Duck, if you know about them, they also do some checking of software and making sure it is compliant and all of that. So they, you will hear from them as well. And then we are going to get into the open source governance, because as you know, so far, though we operated like an open source project within 8 or 10 companies and open networking lab, but now we are getting ready to open source it and create a real open source project around ONOS. And so we want to talk about the governance and how we are thinking about it. And so we have invited Mark Ratcliffe from DLA Parker. He's a very famous guy who has been part of many open source projects. He's on the board of legal counsel for OpenStack and so on. So he's going to talk about generally what the different models are. And in that context, we will talk about how we are approaching the governance model. And then almost an hour when we will have Q&A, next steps, discussion, and a lot of opportunities for you guys to talk as well. Though it is Q&A, but you are welcome to talk about your comments and feedback, and we will wrap it up. Unfortunately, we have to be out of this place at before 5 p.m. So unfortunately, we could not stay here for an evening reception. We tried, believe it or not, finding a hotel for 100 people event is almost impossible in Bay Area during this time. So we had to make the compromise, and we can't have a reception or anything. Informally, if we decide to go out somewhere and have dinner, I'm open to it. But otherwise, we'd like to end at 5.
Just finding a room in the Bay Area this time.
Okay, so I think with that, any burning questions or comments on this opening thing? Otherwise, I will ask Al to come for his talk. And anything Tom or I can answer? Nope? Okay. So let's